Welcome to another episode of Courtside Fracker. This week I'm joined by Sai. How's it going, Sai?
Not too bad, brother. Not too bad.
Good. Good to see you. It's been a while. Well, in terms of Courtside, it's been a while.
Yeah, exactly.
And Kay, how you doing, man?
I'm good, man.
How's that championship glow treating you?
Ah, it's fantastic. You don't see me shining today?
Listen, I see.
Look at this.
I see you, brother. I happen to happen across... LeBron's Instagram feed, and he's going for dinner, taking the Larry O'Brien trophy with him. It seems like he has a brand of a certain tequila, a certain brand of cigar, and the Larry O'Brien trophy following wherever he goes.
I'm sorry for that guy, man. I'm just happy that we won. I'm just happy we won. Like, he could do what he wants. He's on his media campaign right now, so we'll leave him to the season start.
Okay, so that's a perfect segue. This week is going to be a season... off-season autopsy of the Los Angeles Clippers, our second episode in the off-season series. Last week's episode being the Golden State Warriors. We had Ire on, along with Nii, Obi and Harold. Good episode. A lot of laughs, a lot of good insight on there. So as you're listening to this, if you haven't listened to that one, just once you finish digesting this, just click the episode below, give it a listen, subscribe on the old YouTube, follow us on Twitter as well. And as you mentioned, next season, Kay, I think... perfect place for us to start. So Shams and Woj, the two guys who seem to be the king makers in terms of NBA news, dropped a Shams bomb this week. We've been kind of naturally talking about how long the NBA offseason is going to be and what we're going to do in between the time, and we were kind of looking around maybe late January, February, but the news that's coming through the grapevine is that they're looking to start things this side of the new year. As early as December the 22nd. Initial reports are that it's a 72-game season that it looks like they're going to be coming in with. What are your initial thoughts? I'll get into the nitty-gritty of why they seem to be making these decisions, but what are your initial thoughts when you heard randomly, I think it was on Wednesday or Thursday, that the news dropped that the NBA was looking to start on the 22nd of December?
I ain't surprised, because I'm sure people have been seeing that apparently ratings have been at an all-time low, of course. And I mean, there was some good momentum coming from the bubble. Teams were playing well. I mean, it was a very good, I think it was quite a competitive playoffs overall, because obviously no crowds, no travel meant people were normally at their finest at every game. But coming to December, like if it starts on the 22nd on Christmas Day, they just want to capitalize as much as possible, because I know teams are already in pre-season or they're already working now. So they're thinking, cool, how about we start with a splash? Everyone's going to be at home. Let's get it in during the Christmas period and start right away. And obviously shortened season as well. We'll probably get people a lot more interested rather than you get 50, 40, 50, 60 games in normally and teams are pulling out because, you know, they're resting or, you know, load management. So hopefully we get something good this year. But it doesn't surprise me that they'll start around Christmas, because I think they kind of want to keep the momentum going as much as possible, because they've already missed so much revenue. And America does things differently to here, because people are already in America football stadiums, and I'm sure they'll have people in the games for the NBA when it comes back by Christmas.
Cool. That's interesting, because it seems like there's 500 million reasons why they would be starting the season this side of the new year. Estimations are that it would be $500 million worth of increased revenue by, like you say, having that Christmas Day slot. And essentially, they want to start on the 22nd of December and be finished by May, June. And essentially, what they do is they beat the cutoff that comes in the summer. When people are going on holiday, they're going outside, they're not staying inside as much. Actually, in terms of the stadiums and the arenas, they're thinking the other way. They probably won't get people back in. The initial murmurings from the owners were like, we don't actually want to start until we can get fans in, because we want our revenue. These stadiums are just there costing us money. And yeah. We want our revenues, we want our concerts, we want our games. But with the way things are with COVID, obviously we've seen how things are over here, but it's just as bad, if not worse, over there. So they've kind of accepted that. And the idea is a shorter season. And of course, the 72 games also sits well with the national licensing agreements, essentially. Most of them are like a minimum of 65 games, like between 65 and 70. So I think a lot of NBA fans aren't fans of the 82-game season anyway. So like you say, Kay, after about 55, 60 games, it's pretty much where it is. And you've got teams just mailing in the last 20 or so games and basically trying to get themselves the best chance of picking up a good player in the draft. What are your thoughts, Si? Obviously, it's a Nets fan. You haven't seen KD yet. Kyrie didn't come to the bubble. We're going to get into your coaching situation after this, but what are your thoughts about this early start for the 2021 NBA season?
It's a bit of a weird one for me. The NBA usually has like quite a big gap between end date and start date. So this quick turnaround, especially after the sort of playoff intensity and the bubble intensity, seems a bit risky in terms of injuries and fatigue and things of that nature. But at the same time, I'll be glad to get hooped back as soon as possible, to be fair. I don't know if it will have too much of an impact on some of the long-term injury players coming back. I think a lot of the guys were already ready around bubble time. They just took precaution and said, we might as well just dedicate our fitness to the next season. So it's interesting. It's exciting. It's definitely money-oriented. But yeah, to get NBA back by the end of the year, I'm not complaining.
Yeah, of course, this is pending the NBA Players Association agreeing. But like I said, we've got $250 million reasons why they would do so. So yeah, I'm just like you guys. The report basically says that in terms of like the schedules of things won't move up. I believe the draft is on the 18th of November, and that wouldn't move up. My understanding also is that most of the teams have been scouting. They took those 3 months off we had. They've been scouting. They know who they like. They know who they don't like. So the extra time for the draft. Like if they were to do the draft tomorrow, they'd be good to go, basically. So they don't need any extra time. But what it does mean is that free agency is more condensed. And you guys know that free agency, after probably the playoffs, free agency is the best time. It's craziness. We've seen all sorts over the last 5 years or so. DeAndre Jordan getting trapped at home to not sign a contract with the Mavericks comes to mind. I'm not expecting so much this season just because of the hit in terms of revenue and just the quality of the free agency class this year. But yeah, I'm happy to have the NBA come back earlier than we initially anticipated. An interesting tidbit as well is that the Raptors would have to find a home here. Well, I say here, we're in the UK. They'd have to find a home in America because like the Toronto Blue Jays of the MLB, that's the baseball, and a couple of Major League Soccer teams that are based in Canada, they had to find a home in America because teams will be playing in their stadium arenas, but they will be empty. We're not flying to Toronto. We're not flying from LA to Toronto or from Denver to Toronto. So that would be an interesting tidbit. Hopefully Siakam's shot is somewhere to be found in America. So we'll keep you guys peeled on that, and as the information develops, we'll use a Twitter account to keep you guys posted and give you guys our thoughts. And obviously, you said you're happy to have hoops back early, especially your Nets. So I'll just nicely segue into another interesting bit of news. You weren't that excited, to be honest. I think personally speaking, a lot of us have found the Nets quite hilarious so far. Not like a ha ha, you're not serious thing, but just a lot of the things coming out, like Nash being the coach, and then Kyrie, obviously he's got a great relationship with KD, but he's never coached before. And then Kyrie on KD's podcast, obviously, as you know, Si, they'll always take sound bites which don't necessarily fully give the honest reflection of what was discussed, but interesting nonetheless, some of the tidbits. But yeah, it sounds like a certain Amari Stoudemire, last of Maccabi Tel Aviv, in the Israeli league, is going to be joining the coaching team of Steve Nash, Kyrie Irving and Kevin Durant. So what are your thoughts on that?
I was confused. Like the Nash appointment made a fair bit of sense to me. Obviously with Kyrie's words and KD sentiment sort of being blown up, I did feel like it was slightly taken out of context. But this Amari shit, oh man, it's literally like bringing your drunk uncle to the cookout.
I love that analogy.
these men must have had some fun on the road, or they must have some stories that maybe translate well to this younger generation, because outside of that, I have no idea what the point of it is.
You come back for the wine bars.
Yeah, exactly. It's a strange one for me, because I think appointing a head coach that doesn't have experience is not something out of the ordinary in the NBA, especially if you're talking an all-star caliber player who plays a position where their leadership is always exhibited. That side of it made sense. But to then bring an assistant coach with no experience who hasn't been in the NBA for however many years, whose basketball career sort of petered off of a cliff, and who realistically doesn't have a reputation of being that guy or that type of leader. So yeah, it's weird and confusing, and yeah, now I'm a little bit worried, but we move.
Yeah, literally, you made some interesting points there in terms of these ex-professionals coming in and getting coaching gigs right out of the gate. And just across sports, we don't usually like to, or we tend to do it the other way in terms of using football as an analogy for basketball, or the similarities. But it's not too dissimilar from how we see these old legends getting coaching jobs right out of the gate, like your Solskjaer, like jobs that they're clearly not qualified for. It's almost like, because you're a top player, you played at the highest level, will give you that grace to lead a locker room. And it's kind of like that head coach is a position, and it always comes down to, I feel like the team should always be bolstered by the skill set of the head coach themselves. So if it's a head coach who's a people's person, and that's really what they're bringing, that culture, you surround him by tacticians. If it's a head coach who's a tactician, great with the X and O's, not necessarily good with the people, you surround them with a team which makes sure that they're able to maintain that culture. So like you say, Steve Nash, obviously two-time MVP, one of the best point guards we've seen in the league, him getting the coach and has a great relationship with KD, which means he then, as a kind of connection, has a good relationship with Kyrie. Makes sense. Amari, not so much, but we'll see. They'll probably be adding a few more pieces to that coaching team. So we'll see who else comes through. But listen, the Nets look like they're ready. Kyrie wants to win. KD's got a chip on his shoulder. But let's not talk too much about the Nets, because you're going to have your off-season autopsy. And we'll get into the nitty-gritty on that episode.
My shiny black and white cape for the first time.
Probably won't be the last next season. So let's get into it. Our Los Angeles Clippers. We'll start with talking about the 19-20 season, and then we'll go on to talk about the 2021 season. So the 19-20 season, they finished with a regular season record of 49 wins and 23 losses. As you both know, they were knocked out in the second round of the playoffs by the Denver Nuggets. And they sacked their coach, Doc Rivers. So a lot has gone on. Let's start with the start of the 19-20 season. So they seem to win the free agency battle with their Lakers, their esteemed rivals, by bringing in the current, at the time, finals MVP and champion Kawhi Leonard, along with top three MVP player Paul George. And they were pretty much the preseason favorites to win it all. Let's start there. So going into the start of the 19-20 season, how did you guys see the Clippers? I'll start with you, Kay. What were your thoughts of the Clippers after they acquired Kawhi and Paul George?
Like most people, I thought it was, like I said, champions elect. Like on paper, everything almost looked too perfect. Like they got Kawhi, you got Paul George coming off an MVP caliber season. You got Lou, you got Harrell, you got Beverly, you got Harkless, you got all sorts of these people all lined up, and obviously an elite coach in Doc Rivers. So, bar disaster, you're probably thinking they're going to moonwalk to this, because obviously you got LeBron and AD on the other side. We're thinking that's just LeBron and AD. But on paper, the Clippers are everything and more. Probably in the last few seasons, bar when we obviously all expected Cavs and Warriors finals, people were expecting at the end of the year, it's going to be the Clippers in the finals once they obviously walk all over the Lakers in the West Conference finals, whatever's going to happen. But yeah, I mean, throughout the year, they had their issues, which are all like very well documented. Like the first thing was they didn't practice very often, which is actually quite well known for Doc Rivers teams. He doesn't really enjoy towards the end of like the Blake era there. He was like, yeah, we're not really about practice as much. It's more or less walkthroughs, look after the players, blah, blah, blah. And then you've got Harrell just talking crazy. I mean, he's the sixth man of the year, but he was talking like he was running around like he's Puck. Like,
do you know what I think was probably the worst thing to happen to that Clippers team? The 18-19 season, them getting those two games off Golden State led to the guys in that locker room's heads being inflated.
Talking crazy. And I mean, they got rid of all their youth.
Golden State, so you know, you guys are coming into a serious team. Like,
yeah, they gave up the house for PG. Like, fair play at the time. Hindsight's a wonderful thing. But at the time, they thought, okay, Shy will be something. But, you know, decent rookie season. Let him go to OKC, whatever happens. But we've got Paul George here and now, fresh off 28 points a game. Top three in MVP and Defensive Player of the Year voting. And we've got, obviously, the reigning finals MVP. And they've come home to, I want to say, I think I don't want for the word alpha, but more terms of they work well together. There's no big dominant person that's going to be like, listen, this is my team. We're just here to work. Them kind of people, because they're both traditionally quiet. Paul George likes fishing, allegedly. And Kawhi, you know, we all know what he's like. So, yeah, I think it was a weird one because there's just so many things. Like you said, that Clippers-Warrior series probably threw the balance a bit for whack, because they're thinking, we made it without you two being here. And now you two have come in, got all this special treatment. Harold's coming out midway saying, yeah, we don't really get along, but we're good, so we're going to win anyway. So, yeah, I'm not really sure where it all really went to crap. And obviously, we mentioned a few pods ago about Zubac, the Zubac and Harold issue. The people in analytics, and I'm not all for analytics because, you know, the eye test prevails over everything, but people in analytics and the people watching were saying, Doc, yo, Ivica Zubac, he's the guy, he can play for us, he's the one, like, he needs to be playing better on defense, the offense is more balanced. But then for some reason Doc's had his guy and he's like, no, listen, Harold's missed some of the bubble, he's come back, but he's still the guy to play. And when it came down to it, they really struggled. So I think I just want to blame coaching more than anything, rather than the players. Like, as bad as
sentiment is, exactly, mate.
You said elite coach Doc Rivers. So I was like,
in
my head,
in air quotes.
And I was thinking exactly that.
Exactly, because I think it's really down to him how they really struggled, because there's really no reason why a team like this, as talented as it should be, don't walk through basketball. And the thing is, with basketball as well, because there's five men on the court, one or two players can influence everything. It's not like other sports where it's a very large team game. So if you get the best out of these two as much as possible, or one person here and there, then it's going to be massive. As we've seen in numerous series, if one person's missing or one person's added, the series is turned on its head. We saw with Miami against the Lakers with Goran and Bam missing. We saw here with the Clippers in the elimination game, Kawhi and Paul went for a cool 24, the Kobe combined, but they didn't get nowhere. So yeah, I want to blame the coaches more than anything in that case, because they really, really, really should be probably where I'm sitting right now with my yellow jersey on, enjoying life.
Okay, interesting. I wanted us to go through the different parts of the season, but you've just kind of given us a monologue, which is your overview of the 19-20 season. So we can break it down from there. So, you spoke about the start of the season in terms of Kawhi and Paul George coming in, big reputations, big players coming into a team that finished eighth the season before. You had two top five, top 10 players to a team that finished eighth, and yeah, naturally you're going to be looked at as favourites. But what I'll ask you, Si, is that how often have we seen these super teams come together and they actually get it all done in season one?
Never, really. Unless we're talking, did the Celtics get done in the first year?
I believe so, yeah, 2008.
I've been the only one. And yeah. And I think that is the gift and the curse of Doc Rivers. I think because he was able to do that, everyone just assumed that he'd be able to replicate the same thing with that Clippers team. When they got CP3, DeAndre and Blake together, I think everyone expected them to be contenders, and they were a perennial disappointment. So for me, his stock has been dwindling since then. And this sort of last couple of years, his ability to basically get the Clippers team of last year and the year before to perform at a high level. They went from 42 wins, I believe, to 48 wins within two seasons. Managed to get the eighth seed, put on a good show in the playoffs. One of the more entertaining teams as well, oddly enough, even though they were predicated on defense. I think that to me is his career highlight over the last maybe decade.
Yeah, I'm just about to say that's probably
to the eighth seed. And I mean, I was a big advocate of them before this season. So them adding PG and Kawhi, who for me are two of the best two-way players in the game. That's what convinced me that they were going to be top dogs, not just the talent on their own, but the fact that that team had a real identity and a real sort of flow about their basketball. But yeah, it's just not translated.
Let's get into that. Let's get into that. You talk about identity. I think Kawhi is a unique superstar in the way he carries himself, and being a superstar, he's afforded certain benefits of the status. He has a resume that allows for these benefits. The message throughout the season was that this Clippers team does not like each other. Kay rightly highlighted the fact that they didn't practice very much. Kawhi gets the load manage. Let's call it what it is. He gets the load manage, which means he gets to tell the coaching team when he's going to take a game off because he doesn't want to overexert himself in a long, grueling season. And I'll be ready for the playoffs. And basically, look at me. When I'm ready for the playoffs, I'm taking this team on my back. So I think you mix that in, those benefits he gets, mix that into the season they had before where they've had a tough season with a tough series with the Warriors, which is probably had guys like Montrezl Harrell, who's kind of come out of the mud, really. He's come with no reputation. He's built himself up in the league. And they brought these two new flashy guys in. They've sacrificed their future for it. This guy's not having to come to every single game. They're barely practicing, so they're barely really getting to know each other on a practice court either. I think you mix all those things together, and that's a recipe for disaster, really. Something has to give at some point.
Yeah.
Unless you have a coach that has a backbone.
Exactly. And I think if you do a comparison between the championship team of Boston and this one, there's a stark difference in the personalities, because I was even watching that playoff playbook series, and Doc Rivers was the first episode old enough. And that thing of the 08 Boston was Ubuntu, I think that means family or something. And they did everything for each other. And you have three of the biggest personalities on the team. You've got KG, who we all know, one of the loudest ever. You've got Paul Pierce, the truth. Like, he was the leader of that team. He was waiting for someone to come. And Ray Allen is coming off being the man in his team anyway. And obviously, he's quite vocal towards the end of his career.
Well, I would swap out Ray Allen for
Rondo. Exactly. So you've got Rondo, who is well known, Mama French, as known as an arsehole. Like, his teammates have called him that, but he's a brilliant mind. So these are three leaders on the team. And obviously, you've got Ray complimenting them. And for them, they do everything and anything for the team. So it's not a case of Paul Pierce or KG will be like, listen, guys, I'm fresh into the team. I'm going to take some days off because, you know, load man, I've got to look after my body. So, like, there was a case that they interviewed KG and he said, yo, how did your defense obviously change the way the team played? He's like, no, it wasn't me. It was us. Like, my teammates put me in this position, so I helped them do this. Whereas with the Clippers, I don't see that anymore, because you get cases of where they don't practice, firstly. You've got Kawhi, allegedly, who lives in San Diego, nowhere near their home court, whatever that is, their training court. So you've got that, firstly. And then you've got Paul George, who's come off being, arguably, even though he played like it, he was number two. He played at number one at OKC. And he's not really like been the leader anywhere. So this team has already done so well without them. Or I say so well, overachieved in a sense. They lost in the first round, but they shouldn't have been there anyway. Yeah. So they played a certain type of basketball to get there. A fantastic year all year round, 40-year wins, 34 L's, and then they've now introduced these two stars. And these two stars don't align with the mentality that was originally there in the first place. So automatically, is recipe for disaster, all talent aside, because people, once they get these two players, they can either go two ways. So it could either go, okay, cool, we got these two, knuckle down, let's get to the top. Or it can go, cool, we got these two. Well, it's going to be a cakewalk now. And then they won't really kind of stick to the things that kind of make teams great in a certain way. Like when I think that's the way as well.
The one area I will disagree with is I think PG and Kawhi do complement what that group had in terms of a stylistic fit.
Stylistically, yeah.
You won't find two guys who complement pretty much every team from top to bottom in the NBA as much as PG and Kawhi. You can plug and play those two pretty much anywhere. It's just you need that missing piece. You need either a point guard who can dictate, both of these guys have had. I mean, let's be real. As much as I laugh at Kyle Lowry's proven that he is that type of gel piece at the one position. And then as much as I'm a detractor of Westbrook, Westbrook did facilitate PG to be great. And we've seen that both of these guys need that in order to be successful. But the problem with the Clippers is not only do they not have that on the court, in Pat Bev is, for me, a fantastic piece to have on a team for the energy, for the aggression, for all of those sort of intangible things.
Oh, 12 and a half milli you got last year.
Yeah, that's a lot of money, man. you're not there to run around and make noise.
You wash his hair a couple too many times. That must have been
You can't make something happen for 12 and a half.
And stuffed his Tim's or something. But yeah, it's like you either need that or you need a coach that's able to do that. And they had neither, because at the end of the day, Doc Rivers is just not that guy. He's not that guy anymore.
Yeah, it's interesting. It's interesting. And you guys mentioned the parallels between this Clippers team and the Boston Celtics. See, having the same coach, firstly. Interesting. I would say when they first came together, the big three would have been Paul, Ray, and KG. But you have to remember as well, those guys were longer in the tooth. These guys were, they'd all been in the league for at least like a decade. And it's kind of a decade of being the main guy and not actually even... Did any of them get to a finals? I don't think so. None of them had gotten to a finals by 2008. So
Ray was dunking on people then.
Yeah, I think that exactly. I think that makes it a lot easier to buy in, almost like, okay, we've seen that alone we can't do it. But as a sum of our parts, they had a young Rondo who was kind of inconsistent, but you could see the flashes of greatness there. Sam Cassell as well, league vet, respected PG. So they had that kind of culture. But when you look around the Clippers locker room, you're looking at guys like Pat Bev. Like, he talks a good talk in it, but empty calorie sort of player, honestly. Lou Williams, couple sixth man of the year awards. We know what he is. He's a bucket in the regular season, that is. Zubac, who's a great pickup from the Lakers. Harrow, I like him. He's energy guys. You need these guys.
8 points a game. That ain't no slouch.
Yeah, energy guys. You need these guys who are going to come in. They're going to play hard on both ends. Sometimes they're running around, not actually doing much, but they're playing hard. They're getting rebounds. They're scoring buckets. They got Jermichael Green. They got they had a good roster. And
their roster is still the best in the NBA. I'm not hearing anything else, because all of those pieces do complement each other, and we'll see how they manage that with a coach that maybe gets guys to buy in a bit more, or pulls a few guys aside and has a bit more of a stern word with them.
We'll get into Ty Lue. So obviously you both have highlighted Doc Rivers and his shortcomings. So it was, I think we were still a bit surprised when he was sacked, because maybe you guys weren't. I was a bit surprised, just because, and maybe this was my kind of ignorance. The image we see of Steve Ballmer is that kind of that, like, tech nerds, got loads of money. I want to be one of the cool guys. I'm going to buy a basketball team. And I'm like on the sides going really crazy like a fan, but the guy's worth double figures of billions for a reason. You don't get that rich without being ruthless, essentially. And he has big, big dreams.
I think that should be fair to him as well. Yeah. Like, he's put them in the position to succeed as well. He has to sign up on this deal as well. And he stuck. But he bought them when? 2015?
He bought them after the Sterling scandal.
I think that's been like 4 or 5 years ago. So since then, they've lost in the first round twice. Three times, sorry. Missed the playoffs once and now lost in the conference semifinals. Like, you got to get a bang for your buck somewhere. And after
he spent a lot of money. They had $133 million on the payroll last season. He's built a new training complex. He wants to build his own stadium for them. He doesn't want to share one with the Lakers anymore.
Still paying rent, baby.
So this is somebody who has invested heavily and he wants to, like you say, bang for your buck, okay? So I guess when you put all those things together, him getting rid of Doc Rivers isn't that surprising. Before we go on to what the moves they've made and what we'll be looking to get out of them in the 2021 season, in terms of their on-court play, you kind of touched on it slightly, Si, but as our X's and O's guys, I'd like you to go into a bit more detail for our listeners who that side of the game may be a bit more of a mystery. But what is it that you saw on the court that meant they struggled and meant they had? Because listen, Dallas, even without pausing us, did have them on the ropes a few times, and Kawhi did have to go into his kind of superstar bag to take them over the line. And it just seemed like the combined efforts of Murray, Jokic, and the guys around him on the Nuggets were just too much for Kawhi to do that. And listen, Paul George had his detractors the whole time he was in the bubble. So what is it that you saw on the court that meant that the Clippers season kind of went the way it was in conjunction with what happened off the court, should I say?
So I just feel like they slowed down way too much. I think that's one of the sort of negative side effects of having a superstar who can just get to their spots whenever they want. We've seen it with the Rockets. We see at times with even when the Warriors had KD, you stop seeing guys move off the ball. You stop seeing guys try to get involved in the offense. And ultimately, you see less transition buckets as well. So all of those things put together, you saw like quite a plodding offense from them.
Yeah.
Even when Kawhi ended up out of the game, they tried to replicate through either Lou Will, or pretty much only Lou Will, and at times through CD, where you basically just see them trying to beat you with one man, and that's not what they were doing before. They were playing team defense. They were extraordinary in one-on-one situations as well on the defensive end, which just meant that they always kept themselves in a game to be able to either get an easy transition bucket or to build a bit of momentum over the course of a game. So when games did get close, you can utilize guys like a Lou Will a lot better. And that's the disappointing thing for me is Kawhi, for all intents and purposes, showed that he is that guy. He's able to drag you across the line as much as he possibly can. But when your offense becomes predictable and where your defense isn't clicking, you end up in close games every night. And when you get into situations like that, that's where team chemistry and team morale becomes your X factor, which we saw in the Nuggets, we saw in the Mavs, and ultimately we saw in the Lakers too. So,
and the Heat.
Yeah, and the Heat.
Yeah, and those are all areas in which they lacked. I think that playoff run with the Raptors for Kawhi was pretty historic. Do you think that at times, because of his kind of reputation in the league, that the other players rested on their laurels a bit too much? It was almost like, we'll leave it to Kawhi. But it's like, you guys are like, you without him and PG, you're already an eighth seed team. Like Kate said, they overachieved. But you were an eighth seed team. And it's almost like your superstar's there to take you over the edge in tough games. And also, when you're having those times in the game when your offense is stagnant and you just need a bucket to stay in it, that's when you put the ball in the Kawhi's hands and you clear out and let him create something off the dribble. But this was literally how you were trying to play. Yeah, exactly. This was literally trying. So how does that work for next season? In fact, let's talk about Kawhi and let's talk about going into next season. So obviously they brought in Ty Lue now. He was part of the coaching team. He's a manager, coach. He's a coach who comes with championship pedigree through the way of Cleveland. We'll talk about that, Kay. He comes with championship pedigree through the way of Cleveland. But I think, because we discussed it in our group chat and during the Dallas series, the conversation about Kawhi being the best player in the league was had. Do you think he still is?
No.
Do you think he's ever been the best player in the league? And what sort of issues do you think his presence has? Because we talked about defense as well. I mean, at his time at the Spurs, he was the best defender in the league, I think you could say. And he was looking like one of the best defenders ever. Is he still at that level? If he's not at that level, what impact does that have on the Clippers? Yeah, there's a lot to unpack in terms of Kawhi. I'll let you start, Kay, and then we'll go over to Sai.
If we're being very honest, yeah, let's just be all very honest amongst us three, yeah. Offense pays your bills. That's how you get paid. Buckets pay your bills. So obviously Kawhi is a sensational defensive player, as is PG. But well and truly, they did not buy or bring him in for his defense. And to get the best out of Kawhi whilst load managing is not like, hey, dude, he needs to guard best player for 35 minutes while also giving us 28 a game. Nobody does that. That's never happened. And that hasn't happened for years and years and years. So with Kawhi now, you're going to get spells where they need him to guard the best player at the end of the game. And he'll be fantastic at that. But as a whole, that won't be his first port of call, because as the leader of the team, he's the one that you want offensively to get those buckets that carry the load offensively. And we've seen it throughout the league. There is nobody anymore anyway that puts 100% effort 100% of the time, even down to coaching or themselves, on both ends of the floor. Even though they might be two-way players, you can always pick your spots and times because it's just not going to happen. And in terms of him being the best, like, no, I'm sorry. I just don't see it. Like, I understand why it came from him being called the best at Toronto, but people always seem to forget that's a sensationally coached team, that they got very far without him this year. And what the Clippers expected from him, he didn't technically even have to do at Toronto anyway, because they didn't just sit back and say, oh, hey, oof, Kawhi's going to save us. They had Cal playing very well. They had Siakam playing very well. They had Serge. They had Fred VanVleet. These are all very decent role players who all filled their role and at one point throughout the year all stepped up, all while being very well coached defensively by Nick Nurse, of course. So with Kawhi, next year, I think the best thing, they just need to find, or just put him in his spots, because there's one thing like players picking their spots, of course, which is fantastic. And you get players, you can just find them whenever, like your offensive talents. But I think now what he really needs, even at the grand old age of 29, in the prime of his career, is someone to put him in those spots, per se. Not you go and find it yourself. You're going to be here as a result of the system, and then you can go to work. Because if you give someone the ball at 24 seconds, like, go to work. That's a lot of hard work. Every offense, every line, every time down the floor. And then you want them to be playing 10 out of 10 defense. Whereas if you're put in the position by your teammates or your coach, let's say 18 seconds left on the shot clock or 16 seconds, something's happened beforehand already for you to get something done. So I think with Kawhi, like, he's just got to pray that what we saw from LeBron and the Cavs was actually Ty Lue and not just LeBron saying, I'm going to do this by myself and this is how we're going to play. So yeah, I think they'll be fine this year. I say fine. Like, you will definitely see more from Kawhi this year because, as you said, super teams don't win it in their first year. But I think, like, more balance is needed because he's, even though he is a superstar and one of maybe the top two, three best players in the league, he's not the one to give the ball from the start of the shot clock to the end and ask him to make something happen with his robot dribble, because it's just not going to happen. And you won't get the best out of Kawhi that way. Me personally is what I think.
Interesting. So Sai, still staying on the topic of Kawhi. I see you shaking your head. Yeah, go on, sir. Tell us your thoughts.
KD and Kawhi Leonard are 1A, 1B for me in this league. Over the last few years, like, they've shown that they're two of the most well-rounded players that we've seen in the NBA. And that for me is just fact. Like, the fact of the matter is Kawhi has shown in clutch moments and just over the course of his career that he can fit in more systems than pretty much any other player. Even in this clip.
Let him cook. I've been tempted to jump in a couple of times, but let him cook. Go on, Si.
Even in this Clippers situation where it hasn't all clicked, he's still shown that he's effective. Like, on both ends of the floor. Like, he guarded Doncic in those clutch moments and locked him down.
Switched off and got dropped on his head. He left him on an island when Doncic hit that buzzer beater, if we do recall that. He didn't fight through that screen. The screen came and he left Reggie Jackson to get his hairline pushed all the way back. So
for me, that's more of a flaw in the way that they scheme. Because ultimately, you want Kawhi in those situations to play one-on-one. You want him to be the primary defender in that situation. But again, that comes down to coaching, and it comes down to whoever else is on the floor needs to be able to make that direction for Kawhi or whoever else you want on top.
But you accept he's not going to play that kind of defense like 99% of the time, because he's not going to give you 27 a game and padlock the next person or the other team from giving.
Precisely, but that was the case at Toronto as well. That was even the case at the latter stages of his time at San Antonio. Like, the fact of the matter is, though, is when Kawhi is on the strong side, you see teams go towards the weak side and vice versa. Like, wherever he is, guys avoid that end of the court. And at the end of the day, that's a hallmark of one of the best defensive wings we've ever seen in the game.
Of course.
As far as his offense, again, he gets to his spots whenever he wants. It's just over the course of a game, it becomes easier and easier to defend. You can get to your spots, but if that shot is contested by three men, 7-footers, all of that sort of stuff, then obviously those shots aren't going to drop as consistently. So for me, it's more so a flaw in the way that they constructed the rest of the team and the idea that they approached every time they got down the floor is to just put the ball in Kawhi's hands and make him play make and make him hit mid ranges or pull up threes or basically just do everything for us. It was flawed from a coaching perspective, more so than the caliber of player that he is. So I think if they get that right, I think people will have to eat their hat and just admit that the guy is, if not 1A, 1B, number 2 or 3 in the league.
C or D, maybe. Because I really do like Kawhi, but like we're talking all around, like 4.5, like 4, I think it was 5 assists this year, was like almost a career high. Like, that's a struggle for him. Like you said, he's not the one to play make. Like, he'll get to his spots, but when it gets to like the third quarter, people are going to be like, hold on, they're just giving him the ball on the wing.
He's improved as a playmaker, though.
He's improved. He has improved.
When he double-teams, he shifts that ball and he gets it to guys that should
be. I mean, that's. Shot. I mean, you are also 6'8". If you get double-teamed, you should be able to see over and just pass it to the next man.
But the defenders that he's going against are 6'8", too. So
as tempting as it is to let you guys cook, we will be having our NBA player rankings episodes and we'll be able to get into this. Let's stay on the Clippers as a whole. Another thing that you've mentioned is their new head coach, Tyronn Lue. Like I mentioned earlier in this pod, he was part of a coaching team under Doc Rivers. He is an NBA champion. He is also the man that Allen Iverson stepped over when Philly won their single game against the Lakers in the 2000 NBA Finals. Let's talk about Tyronn Lue. I'll come back to you again, Si. Obviously, like Kea said, this will be basically where he shows and proves either it was a coach getting carried by LeBron and everything that comes with it. People wax lyrical about LeBron's basketball IQ, and he very much is the best player and essentially an executive, demanding the players that he wants, demanding the changes in the locker room and in some organizations, getting coaches fired very, very quickly. Is Tyronn Lue the right man to lead the Clippers? And if so, yes. If so, why? And if no, why not?
It's to me.
I think he deserves a shot. I think he deserves the opportunity to prove that it wasn't just Bron. I think I've been critical with pretty much every coach that has ever coached LeBron James. And for whatever reason is, once he leaves, give it 2 or 3 years and they're title contending coaches or they prove their worth within the league. So I think for me, like Spoelstra this year showed that he is a quality coach. And
all this year, he's been this way for a long, long time.
He has. But this year, more so than any other year, he got his other superstar who complemented his style and he managed to get this second unit or these supplementary players playing at a level that was way above their station. And that's what, for me, is the deciding factor in top-level coaches. I think Frank Vogel showed that this year. He's been a good defensive coach since he was Indiana. And again, it wasn't based on how we got Hibbert or Granger or any of these guys playing. It's how we got the unit functioning as a whole. And I think we saw remnants of that in LA. So when I look at Ty Lue, I'm not expecting him to just figure out a way to make Kawhi go from a 28-point scorer to a 34-point scorer. Like that's not what his remit is going to be. It's going to be when Kawhi is off the court or when we need to get Kawhi in a game, in specific moments, how are we going to do it? And that, for me, is going to be what decides whether or not he basically eats as a coach who is only good when playing with LeBron, or a coach that can actually get guys playing above their level and making a cohesive unit that can push for a title. So I think that will be the deciding factor, is how he manages the Ty Lue, not the Ty Lues, the Lue Wills, the Harrells, the all of these guys who were good before the superstars came in. How does he get them gelling with the two superstars? That will be the decider for him. Oof.
What are your thoughts, Kay?
For me, I think even though I was making some faces earlier about saying him at the Cavs, he does deserve his shot because obviously he's not a shot since. However, let's not also forget, like, as much as I love to give players credit, like the two Cavs teams, the one that obviously came back from 3-1 and the one that lost the next year, up until the finals, they're one of the best offensive teams in rating, like of all time. Like this
amazing
stats.
Team,
amazing,
team.
Amazing
2018 team. Team offensively, yeah, were
like,
amazing.
Offensively, like very, very well, clear.
2017, sorry, yeah.
Like, on paper, they were killing everyone. So they were doing very, very well. And you can't obviously put that all down to LeBron. There is some kind of system in place where it worked. So there is that. So clearly offense is not going to be an issue when it comes down to the Clippers. And they need to find a way, like Si said, to get the best out of Kawhi when he's not on the court. And I think not even Kawhi is the person you need to get the best out. Because like he said, he's going to do his thing. It's Paul George. Like, if we're being very honest, like Kawhi gave last year, in an off year, I say off, in his load managed year, in his first year at the Clippers, in his uncertain situation, 57 games, still put up 27, had a very respectable year, was doing very, very well. And I think Paul George is the one people need to watch out for, because obviously he's gone from a ball-dominant Russ, and still put up 27, 28, top three in MVP and Defensive Player of the Year voting. And this year, he's almost become like an auxiliary, almost like a 1C or a 2B to Kawhi's 1A. Like, I'm not sure how that happened. And I think one thing I can, sorry to take it to the Lakers, that they did very well, I think, to get the best out of LeBron and AD, was made sure when LeBron was off the court, it was AD getting his while he was with the bench. And Rondo was there with him, putting him into positions. It wasn't all just ball and post immediately, AD get the ball. So I think Ty Lue needs to find a way to maybe get the best out of Paul George. Because well and truly, him and Kawhi are the same player, but just a different level in productivity. So they're not going to get the best out of each other at the same time. So the best thing for that, I think, would be to make sure you get the best out of them, be it they can both start the game, of course. But whoever goes off first, the person that's obviously left behind, which is probably going to be Paul George while Kawhi is resting, needs to be put in the positions where he can flourish, as well as getting the Harrells, the Lou Wills, the Morrises, the Jacksons, theirs as well. And I think that's arguably maybe going to be his biggest challenge, because they can play defense. They're tall, they're long. Like, that's not going to be an issue. Like, everyone locks in come playoff time. And we can all see that as we've seen in all the series. But I really, really, really think that it's Paul George that is like the missing key, because Kawhi's going to give you Kawhi, top three player in the game. It's Paul George. Like, you can't have a drop off. I don't care. Even you're playing with Russ, who has the ball in his hands even more than Kawhi. And that's even when Russ and Paul had his career year. You can't go from 28 to 21 and people are thinking, oh yeah, this is the same person from last year. Because this situation is supposed to be even better for him, of course. And Doc Rivers is this kind of guy. So that will be the main thing, I think, like Si said, just how they get the rest of the people as much as possible. Because as of now, it's just not working. And that, like you said, the ISO ball, that's normally reserved, I think, at its most effective for the last 5 minutes of a playoff game, if we're being very honest. Like, the people who do it all throughout the regular season and then get to the playoffs, we've seen they struggle. Like, my guy Russ, stylish as they come, but just not very stylish on the ball when it comes to playoff time. James Harden, another one. Like, all year, you've seen him cross people up and do what the hell he wants and taking 15 threes a game, making 7 of them. He got to the playoffs and that just doesn't work. Like, there needs to be some sort of mix where you have a base.
The playoffs, it's all about coaching and the X and O's and the adjustments. It's like, it's almost like you have to have a plan A, a plan B, a plan C. Sometimes you have to come up with a whole new plan because the other team has crossed off your plan A, your plan B, and your plan C.
It's not a mentality. I honestly don't think it's as much as a mentality thing, because people always say it's the mentality of these players that when it comes to the big moments, blah, blah, blah. I honestly don't think this is big. It's a big deal, of course. Like, some people do actually crumble, like we saw LeBron in 11 while the system was there. But honestly, like you said, if the plan A is gone and the plan B is gone, the plan C is gone, but you've been doing this for 82 games a year, it's not a case of mentality. Like, this is now habit. Like, you don't know what else to do when the pressure's at its highest. So if they don't put you in that position, it's not going to work.
That's why the coaches are...
It's our mentality thing. It's more down to the coaching, because they've let this go on for 82 odd games, whatever. And when it now comes to, and they need something from this star, be it Harden, be it Paul, be it Russ, be it whoever, they're going to revert to type, because when the pressure's on, you're not going to think, let me try something new. You're going to stick to what you know. But teams have already accounted for that, because they've seen you do it 82 times all year. So it gets very, very tricky. So we'll see how Ty negotiates it. But I think for personality-wise, he might be the best suited rather than Doc Rivers, because he dealt with LeBron and Kyrie. I'm sorry, but LeBron is LeBron, as we know. The narrative controller.
They got into it a few times.
They got into it a few times as well. And this is someone who's not too far off in age to LeBron anyway. Yeah. So
He's the first man that hasn't been sunned by Bron as well. Like,
exactly.
We've seen Bron literally like take over team talks and all of that stuff and speak over coaches, and Ty Lue wasn't really having any of it. Like, you could see him always just step back into the picture and step into the huddle and sort of just command the rest of the guys. And that's what you need to be able to do.
Has paid his dues as well, if we're being very honest. Like,
he has paid his dues.
And if we're being honest, yeah, like, this is LeBron at the Cavs towards the end was, as we know, coming in towards the twilight of his career, still from that high level. But it's not the LeBron from 2009 to 14.
The end of his prime, yeah.
To do whatever he wants throughout the game, and he's putting teams on his back. These are still world coach teams. Like, he's playing less games and they're still first seeds. Like, Ty Lue did more than enough, I think, to put them in a position to do well while obviously having a LeBron and so forth. But it's very tricky. But I think the personalities on this team are a lot less taxing than a LeBron, personally. And I think he'll do a lot better.
Let's talk about the Clippers roster en masse and maybe some of the things they need to think about and the decisions that they're going to need to make in the offseason. So I think the kind of the looming albatross is a certain Montrezl Harrell. He's come off winning sixth man of the year and he's due his payday, basically. You mentioned in the playoffs, how much of an issue he became, and Doc Rivers decided to stick with him to his detriment. I reckon on this market, he commands between 15 to 20 million per year. So I guess the decisions, they've got one of two decisions. It's either they sign him and they keep him, or the other decision is they sign him and they trade him. If you're the Clippers, you two, you're the GM, you have to make that decision. Which one are you leaning towards? Are you keeping Harrell or are you signing and trading?
Trade him. I'm sorry. It just doesn't work. I really, really would like it to work. But it just doesn't. Like, it doesn't make sense for them to keep him for the type of game that he has. One, he's undersized in his position, which is fair enough. A high-energy guy off the bench, which is great. But I think when it comes down to it, a lot of his game is not very much down to finesse. It's kind of, if it's going well for him, it's going to go fantastic. And as we saw this year has been going great. But say he starts the game 1 of 5, 1 of 6, you're not going to give the ball to him again and be like, hey, please make something happen. Like, you need someone who kind of complements the rest of the team a lot more, because he was their third highest scorer this year, like 18.6 a game. And so they were really trusting him to get the ball, especially when the other two weren't as much in the game and they were on the bench. And he can maybe shoot a little mid-range here and there. Yeah, but I think...
He loves a pick and roll, don't he?
He loves it. But for the money that he's earned, don't get me wrong, the money he's earned, they can't afford to give that to him, I don't think. Because you've got people like a 35-year-old Marc Gasol, who's an unrestricted free agent. He's come off earning 25 mil a year, but the vet minimum, he's eligible for that now. So you're telling me you can't plug someone like that in, or a Serge, who would arguably complement the team a lot more. Maybe not give the same like energy that Pat Bev and he would, but they'll complement the team a lot more than somebody who is at the age still where he can still get his. He'll sacrifice for the team, don't get me wrong. But like you said, like he put up numbers this year, won an award. He's not going to want to come in and be like, hey, I'll take as little money as possible. He's thinking, I'm not them, but I'm kind of the man. Like, I've earned this, and you've got to give me my dues. I'm the third man up. I'm the third musketeer. So, yeah, me personally, I don't see any way they should keep him, because it just doesn't make sense in the long term, especially if they want to win.
Cool. How about yourself, Si?
I actually disagree. I'd keep him. I think if you find somebody who can play big, like proper traditional big, and actually trust them, then Montrez is a perfect guy to plug in for small ball. It just keeps you that energetic, big man-esque rebounds, putbacks, all of that type of stuff. But it gives you the size to be a bit more nimble, to step a little bit outside of the paint and actually like guard pick and rolls a bit more effectively. So I think having options is what it comes down to. I think the Lakers showed that, okay, cool, the big man isn't totally out of today's game. He had three men who at moments just basically acted as a nuisance. You need to be able to guard the Jokic's, the Embiid's, the Davis's, all of those guys. I think Pau Gasol would have been a good option, I don't know. He's only getting a year older. Do you get what I mean?
Shout out, Powder.
I'm telling you, Mark can still do a job because Harold, as we saw, just couldn't play defense when it came to and couldn't handle Jokic, who is 7 foot. Harold 6'10 at a push, maybe with some air max.
Jokic isn't going anywhere. They're still going to have to probably get away through Denver.
And Zubac, as much as I like him, he's still not kind of ready, if you know what I mean. And I get what you're saying, like the traditional big, put him next to Harold. He's a perfect foil and they'll be perfect. They're going back to back with each other. But I'm just not sure who that would be that will fit him personally. And especially because like he's putting up buckets, like he's getting his. Like he's not just there to maybe slide into a role, if you know what I mean. I'm not sure.
That's what you need in your second unit. It's like if you've got a Lou Will and a Harrell, you're basically winning on that second unit, and then plug in someone like PG to play extended minutes with those guys.
Playing starter minutes, though.
Of course, they're playing starters minutes, but they're staggering their rotation, aren't they? So, in those instances, once you get to the playoffs, that's where the guys like a Marc Gasol or Ibaka, they would be beneficial to have. In and around the team, but I don't feel like they need to be a replacement for him. They need to find a creative way to basically get these guys in on the cheap and just rotate once it gets to playoff time. That way you keep them fresh and you still don't lose the things that made you effective the year prior.
Mark will be cheap as hell, but I just think Harrell's probably a bit too one-dimensional. Like it will be a big L to lose him, but I think it could be mitigated through other ways as well because they'll spread the scoring maybe a bit more because a drop-off from like 27, 21, 18, the next person's like 9 or 10. It's quite a significant drop-off in terms of production. So on one side of the ball, he's fantastic. Like, I think he's great there.
Translate that to wing players or a point guard or what?
He's got to find a way to maybe mitigate that because I think maybe a more traditional big man, a bit more experience would be great. I think they'll probably look at that a bit because, like I said, Zubac and Harrell, they're good, but...
Something was definitely lacking for them in the playoffs. You mentioned the point guard, and the next thing I was going to mention is their need for another ball handler, a playmaker. Names we're hearing: Derrick Rose, Ricky Rubio, Chris Paul. what are your thoughts? What are your thoughts? Obviously, Chris Paul himself comes with an albatross of a contract, which means that it will take a few actually serviceable pieces to get him to the roster. But what are your thoughts on them generally needing another playmaker who can initiate play for them on the wing? Bro,
they cannot let CP3 back in the building. There's no way, no how that can ever happen.
That's not working.
Money is one issue, but just in terms of how the team is constructed, there's no way, especially when he pounds the ball for 22 out of 24 seconds at his age as well. Like, he's very much well suited to OKC now with this young team. Let him be their messiah and just show them the way. Right now, I think probably the best person, but I don't think they can afford, is someone in the ilk of like a Fred VanVleet. They can't afford him. But he'll be perfect for them.
He's getting paid this offseason.
And he's getting paid this year. Like he's the similar, but that kind of ilk of someone who can handle the ball and just get it onto the next person, can hit his open shot, and is serviceable on defense. Like, I'm not sure where that's going to come from. Like, I've tried to look through the free agent list and see who there is in terms of that position. And unless they kind of trade for someone, then it is quite tricky for them at the moment, if I'm being very, very honest.
I think so too. I think that's where the signing and trading of Montrell becomes more important. I think getting Montrell in a good sized contract and trading him then allows them to bring in better pieces. They need that playmaker who will move the ball around and stop that stagnant offense that we saw. Listen, Patrick Beverley has his strengths, but court vision isn't necessarily top of that list and keeping that offense flowing. So I think that's very important for them. Ty Lue's a PG, isn't it? He understands the game. He's a thinking man in that sense. So I think adding that to what they currently have is pretty key. I think
bring Austin back.
Say that again. Austin back.
Bring Austin back. I'm sorry.
Him hitting any sort of form is what fucked it up for Rivers, man. Like, can't even focus anymore. He's like, what was that?
It's an option because right now, looking at the free agent market, there's literally, including people with their own player options, there's no PGs available. And while the Clippers have got pieces, they ain't got pieces that people are willingly going to take and give up an option that's going to help them win a title, if you know what I mean.
I hear you.
That's good enough to put them over the edge.
In terms of stylistic fit, so Ricky Rubio wouldn't be a bad shout. I just don't know how he has big enough voice to pull any strings there. And Derrick Rose for me is a championship caliber point guard still to this day. Like,
Man, I loved D Rose to go somewhere he could win, man.
I would love that too, story, to be honest. And yeah, Ricky Rubio ain't ended up there. That's 17 million that the Clippers don't really have.
D Rose is about, I think he's on 8, isn't he? 8 or 15, I'm not sure. I think he's got like 2 years, 16, if I remember.
If you do move Harrell though, then
listen, you end up, man, I'm telling you, you got to get Montreal.
I think a sign and trade, the bird right. The sign and trade can get them a very, very solid point guard because Harrell's got suitors, if we're being very honest.
Of course, yeah, he definitely will.
Undersized. I checked his height. I thought he was 6'10". He's 6'7".
Wow.
So listen, he's got suitors, but I would love him to get paid as well. I love seeing my brothers get paid, but just not
agreed.
I want him to get paid by the Clippers. Let them get the sign and trade, pick up a point guard, and maybe a serviceable big man like a Christian Wood on the cheap. But I don't know.
Yeah, man. just to fluff off that roster. Let me speak about a couple more guys. Marcus Morris, who was on 15 mil last year. Do they bring him back?
No.
His value on the market isn't anywhere near what he was on, but do you think they should bring him back?
No.
I think those are the type of pieces they can afford to ship now. Just get someone a bit more athletic. You basically just have to facilitate what's not already there. And if you go out and get a big man or another wing, you mitigate the need for
Gallinari,
a stretch four. Like, you can find that elsewhere.
Yeah. Patrick Patterson, his contract is up. Reggie Jackson. Do you know who's going to be there next season though? Joakim Noah. 1.8 mil. just keeping the cash cow going, man. Just keeping the checks coming in, man. Paying for all those condos. Okay, so in terms of their roster, it seems like we're in agreement that they need a playmaker. They need something more at the five to contend with the Jokic's of this world and potentially the ADs as well. Because we know the Lakers aren't going anywhere.
DJ Augustine.
There's always going to be pieces, man. Like we say, they've probably, in terms of, apart from LeBron and AD, they have the best two guys of any team. And I guess Kyrie and KD, obviously depends on what KD we get back, but we're talking top three duos in the league. And at that point, it's just about surrounding them with the right players. Like we saw with the Lakers, whose kind of supporting cast weren't rated. They had such a lovely blend of players that from series to series, they were able to adjust. Some guys would have a big part in one series, don't see them the whole of the next series. The Clippers need to sort of set themselves up in a similar way. And what you tend to find is that if there isn't even necessarily a third guy, that by committee, they get that kind of, somebody will go like 4 of 10 from three or 2 of 5 or whatever the case may be. Let's stick our necks out. Obviously, there's a lot to be done. The draft is still to come. Free agency is still to come. So we will definitely be going back and talking about these teams that we're having their season autopsies. But what are we expecting from the Clippers next year? I want to know. What are your thoughts? Because obviously, this is year two. Kawhi and Paul George, their contracts expire. And they've got the player option for the 21-22 season. But we imagine if it's another poor season, they'll both probably pack their bags and try and go somewhere else. But yeah, what are we expecting for next season?
Failure is not an option, man. Like this year, like I think there was the article that came out that I think it was PG or someone came to the change rooms after they lost and was like, hey, it's not finals or bust with us. Yes,
yeah, well, of course it was PG, man. This is a guy at the start of the season was like, boy, you're looking at me, you're looking at Kawhi, you're looking at Montrez, you're looking at Lou. How can we lose? And now he's coming in and saying,
listen, it's not finals or bust.
He's like a catfish, man. Like, the way he's going on about it, he's like,
it is
like,
bust.
Taking the funk of like some top 10 player. And then when it comes to the moments where you need him to show it, he's just not doing it. And it's disappointing for me because ultimately, I'll hang my hat. He's been one of my favorite players since he came into the league.
Likewise. And he's bounced back from a broken leg. But honestly, the way he's looked, I know I said earlier it was down to coaches putting people into positions and blah, blah, blah. But with Paul George, what we've seen in the playoffs the last 2 years, this is just him. He's missing wide open shots. Like, he's hitting the side of the backboard with joints that he was slapping all year. Like, I don't know what it is, but yeah, but it's bust. It's championship or bust. And I know teams are coming back and teams are strengthening, but based on paper alone, even before they strengthen the rest of their roster, they've got Paul George and Kawhi. That's one of the two. That's the top two. If we look throughout the league, I don't care how everyone did in the playoffs as well, including this year. Like, other than LeBron and AD, that's arguably the next 1-2 up. Like, yeah, there's no one else that compares talent-wise. I don't care what Jokic and Murray did. Obviously, they increased their stock and everyone else did. But those two alone should be at least a conference finals appearance. 100%. At minimum. And then from there, it comes down to who outcoaches who or who outplays who. Because there's no other excuse now at this point. Because, like we said first-year teams don't make the finals after, or they don't win when super teams are formed. But now, they've had a year. Albeit a COVID interrupted year, but now they've had their little summer, and they've got to come back and just shut up and play, because I don't want to hear, oh, we're back, we're this, we're that, we got a squad now, none of that jazz. I just want to see them
shut up and dribble.
In this case, by all means, do your social media and your social justice stuff. I'm all for it. But when it comes down to it, I need to see them in the conference finals, because no one else should really compare.
Minimum is conference finals at this point, like, and to not disgrace yourself. I can sort of give them a little bit of leeway, because next year is not going to be any easier in terms of the finals. Like, ultimately the East is going to have some contenders, which this year I think it was a bit of a more of a hopeful thing of maybe the Heat actually pushing the series a bit further. Whereas when you've got the Nets lurking.
Yeah. And we don't even know where Giannis is.
Whoever they meet in the finals, like, they're gonna have problems with that duo if they make it.
Yeah.
And if the Nets are there, then boy. So yeah, the Clippers definitely need to sort of make it their number one goal to make sure that they get to the finals.
So that would be the furthest any LA Clippers team has gone, to be honest. They haven't ever played in a conference finals.
This is another thing. They're a failure of a team originally. Not to sound too harsh, but they've never been in these positions to even win. So even though these players are not like Clippers people, like LA, whatever people, at the same time, if you're not used to being there, or the team's not used to being there, getting there, all of a sudden there's that thing in the back of your mind saying, oh, we ain't never been here before. Not me personally.
Basketball heritage.
That's it.
There's something called basketball heritage.
It's a real thing. Sometimes it really is a real thing, especially if you've got very few players of championship caliber standard. But thankfully, the Clippers actually do. They've got arguably two. So that shouldn't come into factor.
Is there ever a guy to overcome that basketball heritage? It should be Kawhi, though. He did it with Toronto.
Facts.
Yeah, so facts. He did.
Unflappable.
Yes, it's gonna be interesting, because not to talk too much about other teams before we finish up. It's gonna be interesting because I'm expecting the Lakers to be galvanized, expecting the Nuggets to make moves. Murray's gonna come back more confident. Jokic is Jokic, top 10 player in the league. So it's not, like you say, it's not gonna be easy even getting to that conference final in the West. But I can't wait, and yeah, I'm expecting a bounce back season from Kawhi, with a real chip on his shoulder. And like you guys say, Paul George is essentially who we're looking at. Like, can you be that guy? Like, we don't need you. We don't need you to lead the team, but we need you to be consistent. 25 to 28 points a game, stellar defense, and just contribute consistently to you. Like, yeah, some of the games he was throwing up during the bubble, obviously he was very honest and forthcoming and admitted that he did struggle mentally. But and that's interesting to hear, because we don't necessarily hear that side of this. And we, a lot of the times, just assume these players are robots and you just go out there and execute and we don't give them any excuses. So hearing that was interesting and refreshing. But like we say, shut up and dribble, man.
Especially in this case, I think, going back to just to touch on that stuff, I know he said he was struggling. Like, I don't want to put blame on anyone, but I know he's said he struggled in the past with some of that stuff before. Players are coming out more and more, which I applaud, talking about it. But now they're talking about it, and Kevin Love set the precedent a few years ago, players able to talk about it. I think teams need to do a better job of putting their players in a situation where if they are struggling, they can perform because it's basketball first, but they're at least providing with the support. So we're not having this conversation about it's Paul George's mentality, blah, 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 because you can still perform, obviously, while having, I say this tongue in cheek, but I'm sure if he was put in a better situation with the team, obviously, mentally wise, he'd probably perform a lot better. And we've seen this the last 2 years when the pressure's on. Maybe there's something that triggers that. But yeah, I think the team needs to do it. If they know this is the case now, as we've seen in two of the last 3 years, they need to put them in a better position to perform. Otherwise, it's just
for your players, man. Facts. Yeah. Fact. That's a good point. Anything else you want to close on, Si, before we finish up this week's edition?
I think for the most part, yeah, it is going to be predicated on what type of Paul George we get. It is a bit interesting, like seeing him have spats on social media and all of that sort of stuff. Like, it seems out of character for me. It seems like he's trying to play up to what the perception is and of what a superstar player is supposed to be like. When in fact, I think he seems like quite an unassuming type individual who just goes nice. About his business, bit of a like recluse almost. And I think if they figure out a way to get him in his comfort zone and just close out a lot of the noise and just facilitate him with the sort of things that superstars need. Because I know even Kawhi, I think back in the day, they were saying the San Antonio Spurs were one of the only organizations that allowed families to travel on the same plane. And that was what one of the deciding factors for Duncan going there was.
Yeah.
Or staying there even. The Clippers need to carve out that type of identity, build it from the ground up, because they're not going to lose anything facilitating those two guys with whatever they need. Take load management out of it, all of that stuff, but create a sense of comfort and a sense of calm for these guys. And I think the sky's the limit for them. Paul George especially.
Yeah.
Facts. I can't wait to see it all unfold. So I just want to thank all our listeners from this week. Once again, I remind you to subscribe to our YouTube, follow our Twitter, engage with the account, use the hashtag CourtsideFracker, and we'll be back next week. Peace.
Peace.